God, stupid Chris, I can't believe
Chris,
it.
What's wrong?
Oh, Damo, I've got Gus Van Sant tomorrow. I've got no idea what to ask him. I haven't done any research.
Hey, Chris, I don't know a lot, but all this shit, it is your fault.
No, Damo, it's the Wi-Fi. It keeps dropping out. It's France.
It is your fault.
No, it's the internet. It's gone down. The IMDb's been hacked.
It is your fault. You're playing stick cricket.
What?
You're doing it now.
Well, look, but Damo, that's got nothing to do with anything, all right?
It is your fault.
It's not my fault.
It is your fault. It is your fault.
It
is your fault.
It is my fault! I'm a terrible journalist! At the time, I don't even know who I'm talking to and what they've done. I haven't even heard of the Tarzan brothers!
And nothing bad ever happened to Chris again.
Dear God, look at the size of that thing.
Nobody tell Damo this is here, and it's going to take him at least an afternoon to work his way through this. Bonjour the web, welcome to day 5 of our Cannes Film Festival 50 blog episodes. We're here at the Moët Beach, beside this, well, magnum force of bottles that have been assembled and signed by celebrities for charity. And that's Tilda Swinton, and this is Gus Van Sant, which is rather apt, actually, because we're here to talk to him, his cast, and producer Bryce Dallas Howard about their new film, Restless. How was the experience for you? Were you tempted to have your dad and Brian Grazer on speed dial at any point? I mean, obviously they were involved as well, but...
Yeah. Well, when I was meeting with production companies at first, because I knew that I needed to partner up with someone who had a lot more experience than I did. It wouldn't have been fair to the movie if I was the sole producer. I mean, probably wouldn't have been made, honestly. I had way too much to learn. And I met with some different companies and lovely individuals. But it was just so clear that Imagine was the right home for this because they had insights and experience and ideas about the movie that I had never thought of. And I mean, they really delivered. I was on the phone with them, a lot of folks from Imagine, till very late last night. I mean, they're still so incredibly involved. And for me, it's been almost like a very personal kind of mentorship. So I'm grateful for that. And yes, they are on speed dial all the time.
Tackle a role like this without becoming mawkish or treading into the areas of sentimentality. How difficult is that?
Yeah, well, I was really conscious of not wanting to make it sentimental and not needing to do that because I feel like audiences can feel that without you having to, like, saturated in that kind of a feel. So, yeah, I was conscious of that.
And can you just talk about how this movie first came into your life?
Yeah, 2 years ago, I think, it was a screenplay that I read that Bryce Howard had sent me through Imagine, her father's company. And it was something that I thought was sort of... great combination of very sad and very happy at the same time.
Yeah, I've been a couple of times. I came when I was a little baby, and then I came again when I was about 6 or 7. I remember the merry-go-round. And I came again when I was 17 with my dad for a Palermo shooting, and now I'm back again, a couple of years later. It's surprising. I never expected that, the last time I came here, that now we would be doing this so soon. It's like, it's great.
Well, today we received a hot tip. Director Neil Bute has flown into town to talk about his new movie, an adaptation of Agatha Christie's murder mystery, Crooked House. Naturally, we went along to talk to him. However, due to an injunction taken out by a shadowy organization known only as the Friends of the Wicker Man, we cannot broadcast Mr. LeBute's face on the internet, only his voice. So in this next bit, the part of Neil LeBute will be played, and I cannot stress this highly enough, by a very bad actor who looks nothing like Neil LeBute.
You know, it has a questionable... ending, in its own way. It asks characters to make choices that are very gray rather than black and white. And I like those challenges. And so much so that I think Christie herself, who, when this book came out, it was like 1949, was asked by her publishers not to end it the way she did. Right. But she held fast, and maybe that's why it's one of her favorites.
And now to make the very bad actor who looks nothing like Neil LeBute earn his keep, here's the same bit again, but speed it up.
It has a questionable ending, you know, in its own way. It asks characters to make choices that are very gray rather than black and white. And I like those challenges. And so much so that I think Christie herself, who, when this book came out, it was like 1949, was asked by her publishers not to end it the way she did. But she held fast, and maybe that's why it's one of her favorites.
And that's it for episode 4 of our Cannes Film Festival 50 Blogisodes, an episode that's been delayed so long, it could well have been guest directed by Terrence Malick. Anyway, join us tomorrow for more film-related fun, or, who knows, in 20 years' time. Bye.